Sam, it's amazing to have you here for us at Sundance London. Congratulations on a beautiful, if uncompromising, film. And for people who haven't seen it, can you just tell us a little bit, give us a quick overview of the story and what it was about the themes and your character specifically that most appealed to you as a storyteller?
It's such a difficult story to put in a very brief summary, but I'll give it a crack. It's basically set in the 1820s. It follows the story of this young female Irish convict in Tasmania. She is due her release from prison, but her captor, or the sort of salt, the man in charge, me, will not let her go. Instead, he decides, when losing a promotion, to make an example of her, wrongs her and her family, as the polite way of putting it, the very, very tame way of putting it. And then she goes, you know, hell-bent on revenge of kind of getting her own back. So it's a pretty brutal and unforgiving story. For me, and that was exactly what drew me to the character. Like, I think the fact that it was a departure from anything I'd done before, the fact that I would be playing a, I wouldn't say megalomaniac, but a narcissist, and not a very nice person. It was something that was just so different to anything I'd really done. And Jennifer's writing, her storytelling, her ability of being able to kind of make you feel for a man who, you know, I did anyway, in reading him, I really felt for a man who is, you know, has no redeeming qualities. But I think she's just an incredible storyteller. She's a genius. And she, the setting, being in Tasmania in the 1820s, it's a treacherous setting. And, you know, that whole time and place was a very, very dark time in our history, and it was a time that I wasn't familiar with. So there were many reasons to get involved. Honest opinion, my honest understanding of that time was very, very limited, which I think most people's are, actually, when it all boils down to it. And I think what this was for me an eye-opening. I wanted to learn more, and I kind of, what was amazing is that we had Aboriginal actors kind of being a part of the cast, who kind of brought along with that a real recognition, and they shared so much about their culture and what they've been through the history, and it brought so much to my life. I feel like it's opened a new door. For me, anyway, personally, like, it was a very, very violent time, and the themes that run throughout are that violence and darkness doesn't always get you what you want, you know. That sometimes it's you sort of get so, you know, lost in feeling and rage that actually you don't just see the bigger picture. So especially with Aisling's character, Claire, like, she really goes on a journey where she is so hell-bent on revenge, but actually, you know, it turns out that she realizes that she doesn't need that. She doesn't need that to close. The fact that she's already lost enough, and the fact that more people would have to lose is just, you know, it's never ending. You know, it's a vicious circle, literally. She's not afraid of kind of fighting for herself and getting her voice heard. And this is what this story is. You know, she was, after The Babadook and the success of The Babadook, she was offered pretty much every film that going. Because she's not only a talented director, she's an incredibly gifted writer. She was a very gifted actor. So to have someone like that behind, you know, the camera, giving you guidance and kind of, you know, directing your ship, we couldn't have asked for a better taskmaster. For me personally, like, she really took care, especially with certain scenes, she really took care in building our trust together as a cast and as a crew as well. Truthfully, that, because of the journey that we all went on as a cast and a crew through Tasmania, I mean, she wanted everything to be as authentic as possible, as real as possible. And as much as there were certain moments that needed to be heavily, heavily choreographed, we really were out in the wilderness and climbing mountains and in, you know, getting hypothermia. It was a pretty brutal shoot. But I think in doing that, that built us up and made us feel like not have to act, you know, like, she kind of, all the work was done for us by the sort of setting that she'd created and the atmosphere that she created. So I honestly don't think there's any director like her at the moment that I've worked with, anyway, for sure. She's a real wonder. Hawkins is a very difficult character to come to grips with. I don't think I've ever hated a man more whilst reading a script. But of course, the one thing we always told, like at drama schools, you always have to love your character. Don't judge your character. It's very difficult to do that when he's as big a monster as Hawkins. But for me, like, I think I obviously had to understand why he was the way he was and why he acted the way he acted. And so I had to do a lot of research and I had to dig very dark into the, you know, some very deep, dark areas in order to kind of understand people's minds. And we had a psychiatrist on set who would help guide us, and she talked to me about people that she has, you know, worked with, who are willing to share their experiences, you know, allowing her to share their experiences with me. And it's a world that obviously I wasn't very familiar with in no way whatsoever, but it was a world that I was very intrigued about, very curious about. The one thing I will say about myself as an actor is that what I've realised that I love to do is I love to understand people I don't normally understand. Like, that I just, you know, when it comes to films like The Riot Club, which I did a fair few years ago now, that was a world I wasn't familiar with, a sort of type of person that I'd never met or seen or heard. In Journey's End, it's a man who was suffering with PTSD and alcoholism, and that is something, again, that I had never experienced in any way, shape or form. So like, I've realised that I really love delving deep into this sort of research and kind of understanding something that I don't already understand. And that was challenging, man. It was, you know, even during the audition process, Jennifer pushed me to such an extent that I cried, you know, and I'm not meant to, he's a very strong man, but the fact is what she enjoyed from that, you know, audition was that I had the vulnerability, because inside that very rageful, angry man is a broken boy, you know, like there is this sort of aspect of him that is sort of lost and was had a lost childhood. And I think that, which you don't really get to see in the film, but it was just going on that journey and understanding him, you know, it was very, very integral to playing him, I think, and not hating him as much as I mean you will, everyone will, it's, if you don't, I have no time for you, but it was I try to kind of understand him is the word I'm trying to say. It's a part of society that a lot of people immediately go... Hawkins is an extreme example. I mean, the man is all in all bad, you know? Like, he's a bad man and he should be locked away for many, many years to come. But, like, it's... I think with certain other levels of it, there is an immediate judgment or an immediate... what's the word? I suppose we are uneducated. We are unaware, and that's what movies are. They are a source of being able to kind of understand things that we don't understand, or to learn about something we don't know about, or to kind of learn, you know, or to have a release, an opportunity to kind of live vicariously through somebody else. And put it this way, like for me, myself, I don't really often think that I show a dark side. I don't think I have a dark side. I don't raise my voice, you know, I don't get angry, I don't cry very often. So having an opportunity to kind of explore that person, my own person, part of my own personality, is almost enjoyable. It's like an unlock, it's a release. I'm not saying I enjoyed playing Hawkins, I'm just saying I enjoy exploring aspects of me that, you know, I very rarely get to explore. And you know, it's also an opportunity to kind of hopefully show audiences that I am capable of doing more than one thing, selfishly. Like, I want them to cast me in other things, not just romantic comedies.
One of the things that makes you one of our favourite actors is how much you can do, and you've got some fantastic projects coming up. Can you just walk us very quickly through some of the great things we should be looking forward to after this?
I have to say, probably the most exciting thing for me that's sort of coming soon is the new series of Peaky Blinders, which I think has been announced. I'm a big fan of the show, and I play a very, very very interesting character, and again, a very, very different character to anything I've done before. I mean, that I can't talk too much about that, unfortunately. I want to talk more and more about it, but it's something I'm very, very excited about, and excited because I'm a fan myself. So there's that, and then I'm currently in the process of filming a comedy, like a farcical comedy, which is very, very different. Has a bit of romance in, so I've done the romance comedy, but it's called Love, Wedding, Repeat, which is a modern sort of telling of a wedding event told three different ways. It's probably the best way of summarising that.